Meine Damen und Herren, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, es ist mir eine große Freude, Sie zu den 52. Wolfgang-Pauli-Vorlesungen begrüßen zu dürfen. Die Wolfgang-Pauli-Vorlesungen sind dem Andenken an den großen theoretischen Physiker und Nobelpreisträger Wolfgang Pauli gewidmet, der 30 Jahre lang von 1928 bis zu seinem Tode im Jahr 1958 als Professor für theoretische Physik an der ETH Zürich wirkte. Pauli ist insbesondere für seine Entdeckung des Elektronenspins, des nach ihm benannten Ausschlussprinzips sowie seiner Voraussage der Existenz von Neutrinos berühmt. Die Wolfgang-Pauli-Vorlesungen sind abwechslungsweise den Gebieten der Physik, Mathematik und Biologie gewidmet. Die erste Wolfgang-Pauli-Vorlesung fand 1962 statt und wurde von dem Physiker und späteren Nobelpreisträger Max Delbrück zum biologischen Thema Molekulargenetik gehalten. Seitdem haben eine Reihe bedeutender Wissenschaftler im Rahmen dieser Vorlesungsreihe moderne Forschungsthemen einem breiteren Publikum nahegebracht. Die diesjährigen Wolfgang-Pauli-Vorlesungen sind der Biologie gewidmet und es ist mir eine große Freude, James Rothman von der Yale University in den USA willkommen zu heißen. Er ist berühmt dafür, den molekularen Transportmechanismus innerhalb von Zellen entschlüsselt zu haben und wird darüber morgen und am Mittwoch berichten. Heute spricht er über ein allgemeineres Thema, nämlich die Rolle der Wissenschaft in der Gesellschaft. Und ich bin sehr gespannt darauf, was er uns dazu zu sagen hat. Darf ich nun das Wort an meinen Kollegen Nennert Bahn vom Departement Biologie weitergeben, der James Rothman genauer vorstellen wird.
Thank you, Matthias, for the introductory words. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is a tremendous honor and pleasure to be able to introduce our speaker tonight, James Rothman, Professor James Rothman, who is a professor at Yale and currently the chairman of the Department of Cell Biology at Yale School of Medicine. Just as Wolfgang Pauli was a pioneer of quantum physics, Professor Rothman has made pioneering contributions to the field of molecular biology and biochemistry. I remember talking to Randy Shekman at Berkeley in the early 2000s, and he referred to Jim Rothman as being larger than life. Such a reference was exactly how one can describe Professor Rothman's influence on the field of molecular biology. It refers to a person who pushed new boundaries in science and who has made extraordinary contributions to biology in general. Professor Rothman graduated from Yale, where he studied physics. He then continued with his PhD at Harvard School of Medicine's Department of Cell Biology and took his first faculty position at Stanford University. I cannot resist emphasizing that his education in physics and later biology are particularly interesting career choices in light of the history of Pauli lectures that are organized between the departments of physics, biology, and mathematics. Following his appointment at Stanford, Professor Rothman held positions at Princeton University, Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and Columbia University before being appointed at Yale in 2008. At Stanford, already in the late 1970s, Professor Rothman started transforming the field of intracellular vesicle transport by finding out a way to track the fate of proteins as they're being transported within the cell and by reconstituting in vitro the transport of the Golgi complex. Building on this discovery, his next enormous contribution to the field was the discovery of protein receptors that are found both on the surface of vesicles and on the plasma membranes of target cells. These results explained how proteins packaged in vesicles can be sent between cells to reach their correct destinations. This provided the conceptual framework for understanding important processes such as the release of insulin to the blood and communication between nerve cells in the brain. Professor Rothman is a member of National Academy of Sciences of the United States of America, and for his discoveries, he received numerous awards and recognitions. Among these awards, I would like to mention the Gardner Foundation International Award, the Lasker Basic Science Award in 2002, and the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 2013, together with Randy Shekman and Thomas Sudhoff. If I may speak for all of us, Professor Rothman, it is our great pleasure to welcome you to Zurich to present the first of the three Pauli lectures organized by the ETH Zurich, Swiss Federal Institute of Technology. The title of the first lecture, as you see, will be on the role of scientific research in society and lessons learned from a life in science. Jim, it's a great pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for the honor of being this year's Wolfgang Pauli Lecturer. It's an overwhelming honor, really, to have one's name in such an indirect way associated with a scientific hero. And certainly when I was studying physics, Pauli was a hero of mine. There's another aspect of Wolfgang Pauli that some of you may know about called the Pauli effect. The Pauli effect is one in which the great man goes near an experimental apparatus, however indirectly, which then ceases to work inexplicably. It explained why he was a theoretical physicist, I'm sure. It is one, I remember once reading a story of how he was on a train going through Göttingen, and it was unexplained as to why the experiment stopped working, until later it was determined that his train had passed through the station at that very time. So I was actually, even as a student, aware of the Pauli effect, and I was thinking of perhaps not actually going into experimental science. I studied theoretical physics. Happily, after a while, I learned that I could do experiments. He never visited my lab. But of course, there was never a chance because he died, as you said, in 1958, at a very young age of pancreatic cancer, unfortunately. Well, Nenad, I'd particularly like to thank you as the biologist on the committee, because you are now saddled with the responsibility of sharing meals with me and looking after my schedule for the next 3 days, so I promise you I'll try to behave myself. Can everybody hear me okay in the back? Oh, good. Okay, so the technicians can relax. Okay, terrific. So what I'll try to do, the first lecture tonight is really meant to illustrate the importance of basic science for society with some examples from the history of science that also bring out important aspects of scientific culture. The need for the fact that that success in basic science is necessary for practical outcomes. The fact that the pattern of discovery in basic science is unpredictable. It involves occurrences that come together in unexpected ways. That it can only occur successfully in a culture that can take decades to develop, but can take only a few years really to destroy. I'll illustrate that with the history of Germanic science and the rise of American science. And really the challenges that this poses for societies, all of our societies, because you know, at the end of the day, society mainly values and funds the scientific enterprise because of the expected economic and quality of life benefits, which I think even most people in society understand can come from society, from research, but people want to have those outcomes in the short term. And on the other hand, we have a dichotomy because scientists actually don't do science for that reason, for the most part. Most those of us who are practicing scientists, we do science because of the basic understanding it generates, its beauty, and we do it independent of the amount of time that's required. So there's a kind of balancing act that societies have to contend with between the practical application and the urgency of that demand and the patience that is required to allow innovation to actually prosper and succeed. Two different timelines, two different temperaments. And how we balance that really is determining our success. I would contend today, both as individuals who practice science, but more importantly, as societies who create and foster scientific cultures, because the kinds of benefits that can improve the lives of billions of people, they really require the convergence of multiple lines of science in unpredictable ways, and as I've mentioned, with consistent and substantial public funding in ways that are easy to destroy. So what I'd like to do tonight is sort of illustrate these ideas by tracing the lines of basic discoveries that have resulted in enormous improvements of public health. And there are many of those that one could have chosen from, but I would like to focus tonight on the basic science that has resulted in statin drugs that control the level of cholesterol in our bloods, in our blood. And this is a process of discovery that really began almost a century ago. You could actually go back further if you wanted to, but it's easy to go back in a direct way, a century. And the result of this century of work has been the control of blood cholesterol through an unpredictable and long series of fundamental researches, seemingly unconnected to each other, but in the fullness of time, becoming connected to have dramatic results. So let's just consider the stature of the nature of heart disease as it was 50 years ago. I grew up, as a number of people here probably did, in the 1950s and 1960s, and people of our parents' generation, especially the men, were dying of heart attacks in their 50s and 60s. Average life expectancy for a man was about 65 to 70, for a woman, even as now, another 5 or 10 years greater than that. But still, heart attacks were the single biggest public health problem certainly in Western and in developed societies. The rate of coronary heart disease kept going up and up and up, and it reached its peak in 1968. Something happened starting then. The toll is now much less. There are, in the US, about 400,000 deaths per year due to heart attacks versus almost 2 million in 1968. So this has been a sea change. And the death rate from stroke, which is related to the same underlying pathogenesis, atherosclerosis due to cholesterol-related deposits in the arterial walls, has declined about 75%. And this has added a minimum of 5 years of life expectancy to populations in developed societies such as here. So this is an enormous development. And how did it happen? Well, there are really it's happened by controlling two very important physiological axes. The blood cholesterol, which, as you know, largely in the form of low-density lipoproteins carried in the blood, deposits in arterial walls, gives rise to atherosclerotic plaques that can rupture and cause loss of blood supply to heart tissue, heart attack, brain, stroke, or can lead to the opposite, bleeding. But equally contributing and co-conspiring are high blood pressure. And so by controlling high blood pressure and controlling cholesterol, the stroke and heart disease have been not eradicated, but really profoundly controlled, and we all benefit from it. And there are drugs that very effectively control blood pressure. I won't really talk about the history of those drugs tonight, but rather I'd like to focus in some detail on where the statins come from, the so-called statins that control blood cholesterol that largely account for the clinical control of cholesterol in the population. The story, if we were to do it for blood pressure, would be basically the same story. Different people, different specifics, but the points would be illustrated. But I'll focus on cholesterol because it's important, I think, to go into some depth to see the history. Well, how then did it happen that these statin drugs were discovered? Well, actually, they were discovered more than anyone else by Akira Endo, working in an academic laboratory in Japan funded by a pharmaceutical company. And what he discovered was an inhibitor of a very specific enzyme called HMG-CoA reductase. Now, you will hear a lot more about this enzyme tonight. And a lot of what I'm going to do is run through the history of how it was that Endo knew to think of this enzyme as a target for that drug, and what gave him the idea that controlling the activity in the body, inhibiting that enzyme in the body, might control the level of cholesterol in the body, in the blood, and might therefore prevent heart disease and strokes. But the fact is, at the time that he began his work, in the 1980s, early 1980s, it was known that this was the likely target that would help to intervene with. And what he did was he began a screening enterprise where he tested systematically many, many thousands of fungal extracts, in some ways not dissimilar from the way Fleming discovered penicillin. And he was able to isolate from these extracts, from a single extract, from a unique organism, this compound that he characterized the structure of, and he was able to purify this based on its potent ability to inhibit the enzyme HMG-CoA reductase, and therefore to inhibit the biosynthesis of cholesterol in animals, and ultimately in people. And by blocking the synthesis of cholesterol, it's a little more complicated than that, but you can imagine that by blocking the synthesis of cholesterol, that this would lower the cholesterol burden in your body. And indeed it does. Pharmaceutical companies, especially Merck in the United States, picked up on this very quickly, and they produced the first statin drug tested in humans, which worked brilliantly to control blood cholesterol. You can see that lovastatin is closely related to compactin. A hydrogen has been replaced by a methyl group, therefore ensuring a potent patent on a potent drug. Okay, but that's not unimportant, because it provided the impetus for this pharmaceutical company, and later many others who have their own versions of statins, to invest in the research and development, and the clinical testing especially, which is very expensive. A drug like this typically will take cost $1 billion to $several billion to test clinically. So it requires a patent to protect it. Now, what enabled Endo, what positioned him in the 1980s in such a surgical way? I mean, let's face it. If the politicians who fund science could have funded just Endo, they would happily have done that. Because Endo went just right for the jugular. He had the enzyme, he had a good reason to think it would work, and he isolated, not minimizing what he did, but he had the boldness to isolate this compound when no one knew whether one could be found, and he did, and he helped develop that into a drug. But what enabled him to do that? Well, actually, we need to go back to the early 1920s in Germany, and especially in Munich and Göttingen, to the laboratories of Heinrich Wieland and Adolf Windhaus, who actually discovered the structure of cholesterol and of the structurally related bile acids that are used, made in the gallbladder and secreted. They're made in the liver and stored in the gallbladder and secreted to aid in digestion. And it was Wieland and Windhaus who established the basic structure of cholesterol. They first isolated the molecule, and in what was then a heroic effort, before we had NMR and other wonderful analytical methods, some invented here at this great institution, they were able to solve the structure of cholesterol. But what actually motivated someone like Wieland to do this? Actually, Wieland was a natural product chemist interested in all sorts of things. When he wasn't working on cholesterol, he was working on butterfly pigments. Why? Because they had interesting colors, and he wanted to know where they came from. And likewise, his medical training made him interested in cholesterol and in the bile acids. And this is a quote, actually, from his Nobel lecture. "The task would appear to be long and unspeakably wearisome trek through an arid desert of structure." You get the feeling, by the way, this man didn't have much of a sense of humor. Which, according to his grandson, Felix, he did not. But the driving force which steals the perseverance lies in the problem himself. In other words, what he was motivated by was the problem itself. He wasn't thinking about, I mean, even then, actually, it was known atherosclerotic lesions had been recognized by pathologists long before Wieland. Cholesterol and fatty molecules had been found in them. In a correlative way, they'd been connected to heart disease. After all, they thickened and prevented flow in arteries. So it was reasonable to think that somehow this was related to heart disease. But that isn't what motivated him, and it's important to remember that. He was motivated by the problem itself and the chance to do something bold and adventurous that no one else had been able to achieve. So now, now with the structure of cholesterol in hand, we're in the 1920s, we can now begin to ask the question, long before Endo is born, where does cholesterol come from? How does it get made in the body? Because after all, if we're going to understand its ebb and flow and its production in the body, we need to understand how it comes about. Well, the key insight is that the cholesterol structure, and I'm going to take you back to it, You can see it's an absolute nightmare for the biologist. It's probably a thing of beauty for the chemist. But it has a whole lot of carbons in it, and they're in a certain pattern. They're in a ring-like pattern. And a key discovery, the key discovery, actually, is that cholesterol is made of a standard unit of five carbons called an isoprene unit. One carbon, two carbons, three carbons, four carbons, five carbons, and then add another such unit. And if you string a series of these five carbon units together, you get 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, and then cholesterol, okay? Except that instead of being a linear polymer, it needs to cyclize to form the rings that you just saw in a rather elaborate way. But the key insight is that cholesterol is derived from these five carbon isoprene units. And as usual, the most important insights do not come from those who are working on the problem directly. Instead, Ruzicka, working here at ETH, and Butenandt in Germany, parallel and in intersecting ways, discovered the structure of rubbers and of sex hormones, which on the face of it have nothing to do with each other, okay? But rubber turns out to be a variant on the five-carbon isoprene polymer. Testosterone and estrogen are derived from the same nucleus as cholesterol through further metabolism, all of which became clear through their studies. And what further became clear is that the entirety of these compounds derive in one or another way from the five-carbon isoprene intermediate, okay? So out of this came a very basic discovery connecting the synthesis of rubber in plants to sex hormones and sterols generally, and eventually also, I should add, steroids, which came out of this as well, steroid drugs. All of this came from curiosity-driven research, and thus came the basic idea that these five carbon units had to be stitched together to form a cholesterol. So cholesterol comes from five carbon units. Which now, as always, one answer brings another question. How do these units come together? After all, it takes energy to make a carbon-to-carbon bond. Now, those of you with a knowledge of biochemistry know that the principal problem in synthesis, of biochemistry, in biochemical synthesis, is how it is that an unfavorable reaction forms a covalent bond in an aqueous environment that only wants to hydrolyze that bond. And there are many different solutions, but the most fundamental for a carbon-based organism such as us is the production of the carbon-to-carbon bond, okay? And this stood as probably the single greatest mystery in biochemistry after the era of Meyerhoff and Warburg metabolism of carbon about the 1940s. And so actually the answer to this question for cholesterol did not come from studies of cholesterol. It came from the simplest approach that anybody could take, which would be to ask, how does the simplest carbon-containing compound, vinegar, acetic acid, how does it get incorporated into a larger molecule biologically? And this problem was taken on by Fritz Lippmann. And Lippmann, as a result of this, discovered the general mechanism to drive the synthesis of carbon to carbon and also other bonds throughout all of nature involving coenzyme A standing for acetate, okay? So Lippmann made this very important general discovery, which I'll now relate in a moment to cholesterol, but without having any interest or knowledge particularly of cholesterol, he was interested in the much more basic and fundamental question of how is energy channeled and controlled in the body. By the time he began his work in the 1940s, now in the United States, and this is another theme that I'll come to, because Lippmann came from the European environment, trained in Germany, left as a result of the dislocations, and was one of a large number who transplanted the European scientific culture to the United States. And it's, I think, very important point in and of itself. But what Lippmann was interested in is how energy, which is produced captured from food, according to Warburg and Meyerhoff, in the form of ATP, the energy currency of the cell, how that energy, how that process effectively can be reversed, tapping ATP hydrolysis for energy to drive the synthesis of carbon to carbon bonds. And now this is going to be a little technical, but it's sort of fun to go back historically. And one of the fun things for me in preparing this lecture was I went back and I read, actually, some of the original papers and all of their Nobel lectures. Actually, I didn't know this, and I thought maybe some of you might find this to be kind of fun. So how does Fritz Lippmann go about discovering the basic principle of biosynthesis? Okay, well, he takes the simplest reaction he can think of, which is acetic acid, and he wants to see, can acetic acid be added to anything to form an ester? Well, he takes liver cytosol, the soluble sap of the liver, which presumably carries out biosynthesis. And he adds to it any of a large number of individual chemicals, just off-the-shelf chemicals, to see which one, if any, picked up an acetic acid and lost its carboxylate charge. And he found some that did, actually quite a few. They turn out to be artificial acceptors of a certain enzyme whose physiological requirement lies in a more specific reaction. He found, not surprisingly, guided by his intuition, that he needed to add ATP for this reaction to happen. And then he made a remarkable discovery. If he took this soluble extract and he dialyzed it, he put it in tubing that has little holes in it that let molecules smaller than a few thousand molecular weight out, small molecules, but keep proteins in. What he found is that when he dialyzed this cytosol, it lost its ability to transfer acetate to these compounds, okay? So it lost its ability to, quote, activate acetate at the expense of ATP. If he took the small molecules that went to the outside of the dialysis bag and he added them back, he could reconstitute the ability of the enzyme still within the bag to work. So what came outside the bag in those days was called a coenzyme. It works together with an enzyme. The coenzyme was obviously present in the original liver, and if he took the liver and he boiled it to denature the enzyme and precipitate it, he could then separate a heat-resistant supernatant that had all the activity of the dialyzed coenzyme. So in that way, he learned that there's a proteinaceous component, the enzyme, and a small molecule of some sort, which he called coenzyme A for acetate. He was able to purify coenzyme A from a bacterial source that produced it in abundance and established its structure. And he further noticed this sulfhydryl group at the end of a phosphopantothene unit, which is derived from a vitamin, thus explaining a vitamin deficiency, which otherwise would not have been explained. The vitamin you eat, as in many cases for vitamins, a fragment of the vitamin is incorporated into a coenzyme, which is used together with an enzyme and regenerated. So and I'm not showing you now exactly how coenzyme A activates acetate, so you'll have to hold off on that. And the reason is I have to explain how that was discovered by yet another individual. So what Lippmann discovered is the basic principle. You utilize ATP, you somehow activate acetate involving coenzyme A. And with that, he opened up the door to our understanding of biosynthesis. Now, what enabled Lippmann to do this? Well, he was not focused on cholesterol. He wasn't focused on any particular molecule. He was thinking like a chemist, actually. He was thinking like a chemist. How does energy get channeled to drive the synthesis of a bond? And let's look at where he came from. There are two important aspects. First are circumstances within a culture, and the second is an accident, okay? Where did he train? He trained the person I already mentioned, Otto Meyerhoff, who developed the understanding of the pathway of glycolysis, the breakdown of sugar. So he was steeped in the German chemistry enzymology tradition that led to the discovery of ATP and the energy currency. And he was thinking about the opposite reaction, which helped position him to think about the process of biosynthesis. And he went away from what he refers to as an apprenticeship. I'm quoting him here because I think it's an important term. He apprenticed with a master, and as a result of that apprenticeship, in other words, an pre-existing scientific culture, one of the themes I'm trying to touch on tonight, that culture existed in Germany in a very strong way. He partook of that culture. He then was able to carry out research in a way that was not pre-programmed. And without going into the detail of what his accidental observation is, his discovery that you could get acetate transferred to these compounds in the presence of ATP was made entirely by accident. Okay, but as they say, chance favors the prepared mind. So it was an accident. He was not intending to solve exactly this problem, but he had it in mind. And when the accident happened, he realized how that accident could be related, and thus came the discovery of coenzyme A. Which then leads us to the next question. How does coenzyme work to activate acetate, and how does this result in molecules like cholesterol? Okay? So because at this stage, you see how far backwards we've gone. I would just want to take you back to the beginning of the lecture. A statin is a drug. The statin drug inhibits the biosynthesis of cholesterol. It does it at a particular step. If you didn't know about that step, there would be no drug. Somebody had to discover the pathway of biosynthesis of the cholesterol. We don't yet know enough to do that, okay? But I'm working my way up to it, okay? And now you've got the most fundamental discovery, how you make a carbon-to-carbon bond, where the energy comes from, and a molecule that's required to couple it. We also know that cholesterol comes from 5-carbon fragments, but acetate is a 2-carbon molecule. So if you're thinking about it, as they were thinking about it, you somehow have to use coenzyme A to take these 2-carbon molecules and put them together to make a 5-carbon molecule, okay? And by the way, any other carbon skeleton. And then you've got to take these 5-carbon pieces and put them together. But we're not there yet, okay? This is where Feder Lunin and Conrad Bloch come in, who discovered actually the pathway of the actual pathway of synthesis of cholesterol. So the pathway I drew out of how cholesterol is made and HMG-CoA reductase, they discovered this together. But actually, before they started on this, actually it was Feder Lunin who picked up, as it were, the competitor of Lippmann, okay? Lunin in Munich, now Lippmann in Boston, in Massachusetts. And the two were competing neck and neck. But it was actually Lippmann that got coenzyme A, and it was Lunin who figured out how coenzyme A works, okay? So how does coenzyme A work? Here's acetic acid, and it has a hydroxyl group. Here's what happens when you mix coenzyme A with acetic acid and ATP. And I won't, since this isn't a detailed biochemistry lecture, I won't go through the steps of this, but the product of it is what's called acetyl coenzyme A. And this bond right here is what Lippmann calls a high energy bond. So the energy of ATP hydrolysis was used to forcibly graft this hydroxyl onto the sulfhydryl of coenzyme A, releasing that hydrogen, and that hydroxyl making H2O, which is water. So,
better pointer?
Oh, it's fading.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think it's fading.
Thank you for your sacrifice. Okay, so that's acetyl coenzyme A. So that is the intermediate that is used to make these carbon compounds. What happens after that? Well, as I've indicated, we now have a 2-carbon compound, acetate. It will be made into a 5-carbon compound, and then N of these will be put together to make, we will focus on cholesterol, but also up to 6 different steroids, various rubbers, vitamins, and other polyisoprenes. Okay? Hope I'm being clear. So now the next question is, how exactly does this occur? Okay? That was the work of Bloch and Lunin following the acetate story. And we start out actually making, here we are right here. The overall concept is very simple. We take 3 acetates and we put them together using three coenzyme A's to make a six-carbon molecule. Then we blow away a carbon as carbon dioxide that helps make this an irreversible reaction to end up with a five-carbon molecule. And that's what all this is about. Here, I won't take you through all of the gory details of this, okay? I could, okay, but then you wouldn't like that. So, any more than I liked it when I was a student, okay? So, anyway, but I think you can see that we start out with acetyl-CoA, we use CoA at every step, and basically what we're producing at the end of the day is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five carbons. So we've got the five-carbon isopentenyl pyrophosphate, which is an activated form in a phosphoester of the five-carbon that can be then grafted one to the next to the next. So these steps were worked out in an extremely, at the time, amazing set of studies by the two individuals that I've mentioned. Especially by Conrad Bloch. The result was an understanding of each of these steps. Now, for the very first time in this pathway, you will see mention of HMG-CoA reductase. So you remember that's the enzyme that endo will inhibit with statins many years later, okay? Only in the 1950s does it begin to emerge. And now, and then, as one of many different enzymes in this pathway. So this is the enzyme HMG-CoA reductase, which converts this coenzyme A compound into the transient intermediate mevalonic acid. Again, the details don't matter, but I just want to point out, at this point, it's a faceless enzyme in a long pathway. No one has connected it to blood cholesterol. No one has connected it to disease. It's just there, okay, along with 1,000 other enzymes that people have discovered. Okay? So, still fundamental science. Now, what motivated Bloch and Lunin? So again, I'm quoting from their Nobel lectures. The problem itself. So this is what Conrad says. Once again, to chemists and biochemists alike, the structure of cholesterol at once presented a biosynthetic problem of exceptional challenge. He wanted to go climb a mountain. Okay? Okay, what about the scientific culture? Theodor Lunin writes, "My concern with the problem of the acetic acid metabolism arose from my studies in Heinrich Wieland's laboratory." Apprentice, master, picks up a problem, continues to study it, a new element enters, some chance, and discoveries are made. Now, actually, this theme about a deep scientific culture of the sort that enabled Lunin and Bloch is a very profound one. And let's just dive into this a little more, in a little bit more detail. Lunin, actually, as I've mentioned, trained with Wieland. It turns out Bloch also studied with Wieland before he left Munich. Then, after emigrating to the United States, he studied with Rudolf Schoenheimer, another German emigre, a chemist. Schoenheimer, who developed the concept of isotope labeling, which was the key step technology that enabled Bloch and Lunin to discover these synthetic pathways because you could trace individual carbons in a complex molecule. Schoenheimer actually studied in Berlin before coming to New York with Urey, who actually had discovered deuterium. So you begin to see the connections actually between physics, chemistry, and biology. And I could track this back actually to the Curies if I wanted to, but I won't, okay? Because it is amazing how much connectivity there is, and not just at the level of, you know, this formal description, but at the level of who is friends for who with who interact with who socially, in what society. That is the type of deep scientific culture that is absolutely required for success. Now, actually, Wolfgang Pauli, in his life and career, also illustrates this. Pauli was born in 1900 in Vienna. His godfather was Ernst Mach, the physicist. He studied with Sommerfeld in Munich, where he received his PhD degree. He did the grand tour of Europe, as people did in those days. He worked for a year with Max Born and Göttingen. He then worked with Niels Bohr in Copenhagen. In 1928, he came to this institution as a professor in physics. He left in 1939 or 1940, the key event being the annexation of Austria by Germany in 1938, which forced him to become a German citizen. As it turns out, his forebears on all sides were Jewish, though they had converted to Roman Catholicism in later generations. But obviously, he felt threatened. He was unable to stay here in Switzerland. He wasn't allowed to be a citizen. And so by 1940, he had emigrated to the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. Now, unlike many other, there are many stories like this. And this story, I mention it because this is the Pauli lecture, obviously. But this story occurred over and over again, dozens and dozens, hundreds of times. And the result was a massive graft of talent onto a humdrum United States, then humdrum scene in science, which of course has had tremendous historical significance for my country. Unlike most of his fellow emigres, though, as you heard, Pauli returned after the war in 1946 or so to this institution, where he died about a decade later. But I bring up this because, again, I want to develop the theme of what underlies the success of science and its contribution to society. Our contribution to society is not just the literal discoveries, but it's also the social environment and the training environment. So now I'd like to turn to more modern discoveries, namely, how does the body control its level of cholesterol? And there's actually two key questions. Within the pathway of cholesterol biosynthesis, which, if any, of the block lunin enzymes could be a target for a drug controlling cholesterol? So was it HMG-CoA reductase or any of 20 other enzymes? And by the way, if you controlled the excess cholesterol, would that actually affect heart disease? There's correlation that says you have high blood cholesterol, whatever, you have a higher chance of cardiac attack, heart attack, but there are lots of people that don't have particularly high blood cholesterol that also have heart attacks. So, you know, like everything, there isn't any one kind of heart disease. But what are really the answers to these questions? And the answer came from the study of a disease called familial hypercholesterolemia. And these are relatively rare individuals, but not that rare, about 0.1 to 1% of the population, that have two copies of a rare single a bad gene, okay? And that gene, which is inherited as a Mendelian gene, causes early death by heart attack. So if you have a homozygous, if you're a patient with two copies of the bad gene, you will likely die of a heart attack in your teens or your 20s at the latest. And you will have atherosclerosis that is fulminant as if you were a much older individual who died of a heart attack, but at a much younger age. You have rampant levels of blood cholesterol. And so what this shows is that in a very determined way, and it really proves that at least for some patients, excessively high concentrations of cholesterol in the form of low-density lipoproteins is the causative agent for heart attacks. This was discovered by Brown and Goldstein in the United States, and they identified the gene that is wrong in these patients, and then based on that gene, they established and discovered the pathway that operates in the liver and in throughout the body that balances the cholesterol in your blood. And it's a combination of a receptor. The gene, actually, FH gene, encodes a receptor that binds these lipoprotein LDL particles out of the blood and causes them to be digested within the cell, captures their cholesterol, and reutilizes it for the body's own purposes, of which you've heard several, for making membranes, for making bile acids, for making steroid hormones, and the like. At the same time, it utilizes the cholesterol it's taken in to repress the synthesis of the body's cholesterol synthetic pathway. So this gene functions in two ways. First, it clears excess cholesterol from the blood, and when you have excess cholesterol, it controls the metabolic pathways so that you make less of it. So it actually works rather well. It's important. And when you lose that gene, you obviously have a big problem. Okay? Now, Brown and Goldstein also discovered where within the cholesterol synthetic pathway, what actually is regulated through this pathway, what enzyme. It turns out it's the HMG-CoA reductase enzyme. So they discovered that this, through this genetics, that if you were to modulate LDL, you would expect to control heart disease. That was no longer some loose association. It was a fact. And they discovered within all of the enzymes in this pathway that this is the one that is naturally regulated by that gene, HMG-CoA reductase. So as a result of Brown and Goldstein's discovery, it became possible for endo, it focused endo on HMG-CoA reductase. As a result of Bloch's work, there was an enzyme assay for HMG-CoA reductase. And then as a result of endo, there was the discovery of this fungal metabolite that that led to the drugs. And so to summarize a long and winding lecture, okay, we start with the chemical structure nearly a century ago of cholesterol. We then learn that it has, we learn of the common origin of a series of related compounds from 5-carbon units. We learn of the general principle that activates hydrocarbon units for biosynthesis. We learn how this activation is used to produce 5-carbon units and thus the role of HMG-CoA reductase in the process of making cholesterol molecules. We learn the basic mechanism by which the body controls cholesterol and that it does so by regulating the activity of this very enzyme. And then most recently, we learn a compound that acts like a drug but isn't actually a drug, but can be developed into a drug to produce the first statin to save untold millions of lives. So this is really an extraordinary story of basic science. And what lessons can we learn from this study? And I think I have another perhaps 10 minutes or so to kind of encapsulate what we can learn. Well, my goodness, we lost everything here. Okay, that's really a pity. Okay, well, what I was going to show you here was a figure from the work from an article, an influential article by Hans Krebs on the making of a scientist. And what he did was he traced his own origin as a scientist to what has now been blanked out. I'm really sorry about this. It all goes back to one individual, von Bayern, who was an important dye chemist of the late 19th century in Germany. His progeny, their progeny, their progeny, and their progeny include all of the people whose names I mentioned tonight and many others who've made important contributions to this and to other fields. It just really emphasized, and that was really the point of his article, was that this genealogy of scientific contribution, and we see this in every field of science, it doesn't have to be this, this is purely illustrative. It is clear that there is a scientific culture that is taught master to apprentice that takes place in a broader scientific culture that is multi-generational and it takes decades to establish. And yet, as we saw in the events of World War II, in a matter of a few years, can be destroyed. So it is a very, very, and I just, this I guess was meant to be, to show that in more recent years since the article of Krebs, actually Brown and Goldstein come from the same lineage, and actually I do myself. So this lineage still continues. The major difference is that you can draw a line about here, and everything above here occurred in Europe, primarily Germany, but also Switzerland. Everything below here occurred in the United States. Now that isn't necessarily going to continue, okay? In fact, if anything, the pendulum may be moving the other way, but it's a very interesting and historical fact. And so I think we have to recognize that what is illustrated here, which is that we tend to think of science as rational, and it is. What we do with science is we take information and we organize it to increase predictability. That's sort of what science does. But the discovery of science is in fact a process that is very human. It's unpredictable, it's impacted by personality, by circumstances and emotions. And all of that I incorporate in the term scientific culture and this multi-generational rich scientific culture. The other thing we learned is that the long-term impact of a discovery is unpredictable at the time. I mean, no one, if you go back through the story that I just told you, at any one time, I don't think anybody would reasonably have predicted that a cornerstone discovery was being made that would cure or ameliorate heart disease many years later. Just would never have been predicted. So this brings us to the subject of what motivates societies to fund science. Why do people pay for us? You know, we actually, most of us go into science because, you know, frankly, it's sort of fun, okay? You know, and, you know, there's a bunch of other motivations, but basically it's kind of fun and it's challenging. But you know, somebody actually pays you to do this? It's an astonishing fact, okay? And why does society do it? Because people, us as citizens, we all want to have technologies that, for example, in medicine, create new treatments that improve life, and we want results in the short term. And short definition of short term is within the lives of each of us individually. So we can say, certainly within 100 years, but you know, everybody gets a little older, so at a certain point you want it within 20 years, okay, or maybe less. So everybody's motivated in the short term. But then, as you saw, and as many of you understand, the scientists who do the work are motivated by rather different things. And we have a sense of patience. I mean, it's true that we can be impatient people as individuals, but we understand that important discoveries emerge in the fullness of time, and they're not always directed. And this brings me to the theme that I introduced at the very beginning, patience and urgency. Because these are two fundamentally polar opposites, patience and urgency, that on the one hand characterize scientists and the societies that pay for us. Societies have a sense of urgency. They want their problems fixed, our problems fixed. Scientists, motivated by other things and that. And we have generally an understanding of the process that requires patience. And societies somehow have to learn to become a little patient with science. And when they are, I would contend they're very successful. And the type of discoveries that I just outlined can and do occur. And what I'd like to do is now take three different parts of the world and briefly just offer my personal views about how patience and urgency, how these two processes are, this dynamic is playing out, has played out historically, and what the trends are. I can speak, of course, with more authority about my own country. I've already emphasized the dramatic successes that we've had in the United States, recognized around the world, following World War II. We understand the reason for that, and I've already mentioned it several times. We've had a dramatic expansion in the funding for research. It's been exponential, actually, from about 1959, when Sputnik scared the wham out of the politicians, to relatively recently, maybe 10 or 12 years ago. And we have failed to transition to a steady state mode. This is actually everybody's fault. We're adapted to continuing growth. We continue to manufacture, in an entrepreneurial culture, students and postdoctoral fellows when we don't have an exponentially increasing number of jobs. We have a business model for universities that builds buildings with the hope that people will come to accommodate it. And as professors and teachers, we also, frankly, haven't taken, in the way we structure our labs, we haven't somehow come to take this into account. Instead, what we've seen is the opposite. The National Institutes of Health, which pays for the life sciences mostly, our budget, in absolute dollar terms, has gone down 30% over the last 20 years. So it's down 30%. And roughly half of that is being organized by politicians and scientific politicians for what can only be described as top-down, targeted, short-term studies that are inherently unstable because they're purpose-directed. And if the latest war on cancer doesn't produce the cure, there will be less interest in the next war on cancer. So the real question, I think, for the United States is 75 years after the transplant of Germanic science, you know, we were the fortunate beneficiary of the best scientific culture in the world. and it has taken. The question is that graft going to be rejected by the host? Because the American host has always been known for the practical. You know, we invented the telegraph, the cotton gin, okay, we can make the first plane fly, but we didn't discover basic principles. So that's the history of American science is more engineering. And so whether the United States will flip back to form, I don't know. That's our existential challenge, I think, as a society. Europe. Well, obviously, I'm less of an expert. Here, we have, in many ways, the opposite problem. We have the drain that World War II caused. There's been a steady regrowth and redevelopment, probably somewhat less so in Switzerland, which was relatively spared, but throughout much of Europe. And we've now seen quality and importance of research has risen to world-leading levels, and that's really very gratifying. On the other hand, with the possible exception of Germany and Switzerland, Europe suffers everywhere I go when I talk to my colleagues from what seems like chronic underfunding. And so the real challenge, but on the other side, you have university structures, such as here, that provide a certain research benefit to the tenured faculty that provides stability. Not necessarily for big research effort, but enough to stabilize the enterprise. And those structured organizations are what I refer to when I talk about adjusting to the steady state. Europe has been in a steady state for a much longer time, even before the events of the Second World War, because obviously the history of science goes back much further here. But then the question is, I think the challenge here is, as we move into a more European stance in this continent, the question is, how is science going to be structured? And it seems to me that the dangers of bureaucratic science, collaboration for collaboration's sake, transnational bean counting of one sort or another. Everywhere I go, including at dinner tonight, I hear complaints about, collaborations are wonderful, but unnatural collaborations, it's like man and beast. So they shouldn't happen. But how are you going to resolve that? I don't know. How can you try to bring Europe together and at the same time not do this? How can you? We have a Faustian deal. We turn to government, which is a big bureaucratic organization, for funding. And when we're small, it's okay, but when we're big, we interface government as a bureaucracy also. So how can we minimize this? I don't know. And then, of course, China, where currently there's an explosive increase in funding. It's said that the R&D budget for China this year will cross over and exceed that of the United States of America. I'm not sure that's exactly true, because the Chinese are not super transparent about what their budgets are, but it's certainly definitely getting up there. So their challenge is actually not money, it's culture. And really the question is, it's a patriarchal society, and what I sense when I visit China several times a year is that the relative lack of transparency, even in the scientific community, and a culture that is not transparent, that's built on five-year plans. How does that sense of urgency, prescription, how does that interface with the sense of patience, for which also, by the way, Chinese culture is associated, but how does it mesh with that sense of patience in the development of a multi-generational, multi-decade culture? Certainly science is and will develop in China, but it may be more challenging than many of the Chinese friends I have think, because they will need to establish this multi-generational rich culture, they will need to do it in a society that is inherently more patriarchal than European or American society. So then, do I have two or three minutes to just mention one or two more things? I promised in my abstract that I would try to relate this to the challenge that young scientists have, and I notice a number of relatively young faces here, although I have to say every year as I get older, the faces, even older faces look younger to me. So I thought I would try to capture some of this, along with some lessons from my own life, in terms of some advice. So I've sort of stressed this theme of patience versus urgency at the societal level, but I mentioned that I believe it also applies at the individual level. and how we as individuals balance our sense of urgency. We really want to get it done. We're pressured for some immediate goal. Maybe it's not curing cancer, but it might be getting a research grant or getting a paper published or whatever. How do we balance that with the long-term goal of focusing on the fundamental, really doing it right, all the things that that represents? Well, first question that people come to ask me about, I advise a lot of undergraduates at Yale, is should I go into research? And of course, you're really hard-pressed to try to answer that for somebody. It's a very personal question. But what I find is that the best scientists and artists actually have a lot in common, and that there's a lot of intuitive vision and emotion that are associated with actually being on the edge. So if someone says to me, I want to go into science because I think I can find my niche, I say, maybe you shouldn't go into science because, you know, after all, why do you want to be a Darwinian finch? But if someone said to me on the other side, if I said, well, what would happen if I said you can't go into science for some reason? Just, you can't do it. And if someone says to me, I would feel like, which is, by the way, how I felt, that someone had kicked me in the stomach, and I just couldn't imagine it, then you should go into science. So I think that if you had a son or a daughter who wanted to write a novel or be a painter, as a father or a mother, you would want to discourage them. But you wouldn't in the end if they felt that there was nothing else that they could do. So that's the analogy I'm trying to draw. How do you get started choosing a problem? Well, I had the privilege of apprenticing as a young faculty member to Arthur Kornberg, who discovered the mechanism of DNA replication in the early 1950s. And I said, Arthur, what gave you the idea to do that? And he said, well, he said it was something that I thought was really important, but and everybody else thought probably it was important, but nobody thought it could be done. Okay, but I thought maybe it could be. So I would just pass that piece of advice along. Also, with another one to come about how failure is a good thing, because if you take that approach, you're going to fail most of the time. Now, next theme I'd like to focus on is the fact that science, while it's fun, is also incredibly hard. And so, you know, you have to be prepared to engage in a huge amount of frustration. I actually think the reason most experimental biologists like myself get out of the lab at a certain point is that it's just too hard to fail every day. But if you have 10 people that are failing every day, it's a lot easier on you emotionally, and one of them every few days will have some success. You can relish that. Okay? Science is hard. And in that connection, don't be afraid to be stupid. Okay? I just had a case in my own lab where somebody just lost 3 weeks because the schmuck didn't ask somebody a question who was at the next lab bench. Okay? Still happens in this world. If you don't understand something, it doesn't mean you're stupid. It means it probably was unclear. You should ask. Probably everybody else wants to know as well. Okay? Troubles are good for you. I learned this from a book written by the famous biochemist Ephraim Racker, who invented what he called the tag fee for philosophy, which he illustrates in his work. And many times I have found when things stop working, nature is trying to tell you something. Okay? You are about to make a discovery. Okay, because conventional thinking didn't lead to the answer you expected. So you can either give up, which is what most people do, or embrace this philosophy, which will enable you, maybe, to make a discovery. It's happened to me several times. Which brings another point, because you see, science is also an art form. See, if you're hitting your head against a brick wall, find a new wall. Now, how many times have you tried the experiment? 3, 4 times. Or your student comes to you, I tried it 4 times. I'm going to try it a 5th time. Why would you want to do that? If you hit your head against a wall 4 times and you got bruised 4 times, why would you do it a 5th time? Okay? So it's only human to have that hope, and that's balanced against troubles are good for you, but that it's somehow in that balance that remarkably most people will somehow keep hitting their head against the wall, I've observed. But anyway, there we are. Now, another point. It's very easy to start a project, okay? We all feel good, had a good idea, start a project. Hardest thing in the world is to stop a project. By the way, that's true in everything, not just science, because your ego gets involved in it, okay? Forget it. It's not about ego, okay? Sure, ego is a driver. We're all driven by ego. But at some point, you got to look at it and say, no, it doesn't work. People that can do that more often are going to be more successful. If you reach out, because you're not necessarily the smartest guy in the room, you don't know everything, it's okay not to know everything. Go outside your comfort zone. The most important collaboration I ever had was with Lelio Orci in Geneva over many years, one of the foremost, if not the foremost, electron microscopist of his generation. Certainly, what we were able to contribute could not have happened without his contribution. And it wasn't convenient, especially in the era of fax machines. This is what I learned from my thesis advisor more than anything else. Sometimes there's no justice. You know, it's good to be smart. It's actually better to be lucky. Okay, so don't be so smart that you don't take advantage of something that comes your way. And this comes back to the point about science is hard, be flexible. When things aren't working, don't hit your head against the brick wall. Because mostly, it's very discouraging. 99% of the time, or whatever number you wish, you're going to fail. Actually, an average, very good scientist fails 99% of the time. The great scientist, perhaps through better intuition, fails 90% of the time, but still fails 90% of the time. Everybody fails. It's a good thing. We are inefficient. There's no two ways around it. So finally, what I'd leave you with is what I think is the greatest discovery that was ever made, and that is in science, which is the scientific method itself. If you think about it, anything that any of us have achieved or will achieve, or any of our predecessors, or any of our successors, is actually based on the scientific method. And what I've outlined for you at a more humanistic level is what it takes to actually, in my experience and my observations, practice the scientific method successfully. But the whole notion that there is a scientific method was itself a discovery. It was long born out of the process of pagan religion, more modern religions, philosophy, natural philosophy, scientific method. We all know that story, but it's important not to forget it, because it is on the basis of the scientific method that we continue to make the kinds of contributions as a group and as a scientific society that society values. And just an incredibly inspiring quote, I think, on the endless potential of the scientific method comes from Buchner, who was really the founder of modern biochemistry. It was he who discovered that cells could be broken open and metabolized. He literally opened the door to biochemistry. And I'll just let you read it. I mean, this was written in 1907, okay, long before metabolism was discovered, but he had the vision that there wasn't anything about the organization of a cell or its chemistry that was beyond our capability. It was really extraordinary, just extraordinary. So I leave you with those thoughts, and thank you very much. Take questions? Or is that not allowed?
It's usually not the way it's done, but I think we can break the mold and open the floor to questions, because Jim is ready to answer.
I'm happy. If the people want to leave, because it's late, leave.
No, but...
I just arrived this morning. I am going to be good till 3 a.m. But don't find me in the morning. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to try to address them.
There's a question up on top.
Wave your hand, please. Okay.
So your main message about the need for patience, how do you get early to society? You
make many people. First of all, I don't know that you really can in any one interaction. It's funny, this is what we were discussing at dinner tonight. But I think that as many of us as possible on occasions like this, where I'm probably mostly preaching to the converted, but also on other occasions when you meet with your colleagues in business or politics, on other social occasions, some of us have opportunities to speak publicly in various venues, including political ones. It's incumbent on us to develop that message. And most of the time, people won't listen. Maybe once in a while you'll get someone that does, and maybe that'll be an impactful person. You know, on the whole, I'm not optimistic.
There's a question down there.
You mentioned the European university system as a measure that supports stability, but isn't that a trade-off with complacency? With people who have long lost the drive to really find anything new and don't make space for new people who still have that? How do you see this?
Okay, well, now that's interesting, okay? What you say, of course, is right in a general way, okay? But it's also true that in Europe, you have a retirement age, okay? And it's 65, sliding towards 67. Artful individuals can dodge a little bit for a few years, okay? I know that's what I would be doing if I were here. But there is a retirement age. In the United States, there is no retirement age, so professors are commonly staying into their 80s. Yes, and by the way, I should say, contributing quite actively in many cases, okay? Not every case, okay? So there's that one element of it, okay? Stability does, at another level, provide for complacency if you provide enough funds to the investigator that they never have to be accountable to the outside world, okay? So a classic example of that would have been the Max Planck Institutes, okay? Which have suffered for complacency in many years. On the other hand, it seems like more MPI investigators are competing for outside grants. They're taking in young people, at least on contracts. Again, I'm not an expert on all of the trends, but they're moving in that direction in a significant way. Your institution hires assistant professors on a tenure track, which is not a typical European structure. But you, on the other hand, like a more European, a traditional European structure, support laboratories in the longer term. But I believe still, correct me if I'm wrong, have a retirement age. So there's a mix. At the end of the day, there is no perfect solution. But the less dependent we are, so let's take the other extreme. At an American medical school, in the extreme, the individual the professor is given the title professor and the opportunity to apply for grants. No grants, no salary. Okay? And today, a 15% chance of getting your grant. Now, I would say that's highly motivating to write grants. The average American medical school professor, according to the NIH, spends 50% of his or her time writing grants. Because you have to take a pipeline approach, right? Like drug screening, okay? To get the one, okay? Not everybody, but it's really distressing. So there's no such thing as complacency. That's not healthy either. But the young guy has got just as much of a chance to compete, okay? Do you want that chance? So somewhere in between, that's why I see the two, it's a very interesting question. I don't have an answer, really, except to say that every society has its own culture and history. Every society has to come up with its own answer. But somehow those factors have to be balanced in it. And I have the feeling that the appropriate balance hasn't yet been achieved in Europe. But maybe better, closer to being achieved, because you came from more of a steady state history than in the United States, which came like a rocket ship up in the 1950s. We really haven't come to cope with this at all. So I actually think that, I frankly advise my postdocs that they should come to Europe to start their labs when possible. Because I think that, I know there are limitations and there aren't as many programs that entitle the young investigator to absolute freedom. But sometimes it's better to have less than absolute freedom, but to have some protection. So it's all a balance. I think that there's the ideal method, as far as I'm concerned, is the way it was in the United States when we grew exponentially, and the young person, as I was enabled with no restrictions. Our society doesn't somehow allow that anymore. So short of that, I think you may have a better approach over here, quite frankly. I'm not sure it's the perfect approach. There is no perfect approach. It's a work in progress.
Okay, we would have a chance for one more question. Well, okay, two.
So you were lauding the system of being a master, apprenticeship, and at the same time you pointed out that there are not enough positions for the apprentices to become masters. Mm-hmm. What is your take on scientific staff in academic laboratories? Would that be a good way to become a mini-master, for example, or are you against
Okay, what you just described, the classic Geheimrat system, Okay? You described science as it was in Germany, for example, before World War II, or as it is in many German universities, or was until, let's say, 10 or 15 years ago, when you had the professor who was the chair of the department. The department consisted of people who were largely internally appointed, who had professor rank somewhat below, increasing teacher load, and increasing teaching load and decreasing rank, but nonetheless were tenured faculty. Most of us will remember C2, C3, C4. I don't know what the equivalents were in Switzerland, because I don't know the system as well. That is precisely what you're describing, okay? And it's a form of, it's a way to achieve stability. In the United States, we haven't adopted that yet, but we're incrementally moving towards that, because as postdocs go from one postdoc of, well, let's say, when I was young, let's say my thesis advisor, Eugene Kennedy at Harvard, did a one-year postdoc with Fritz Lippmann. That was it. Didn't publish anything. Didn't matter, okay? Because he was looking for high-energy phosphate bonds that didn't exist. So, good, didn't find it, but he was a smart guy. Lippmann said he's a smart guy, so he got a good job, okay? Conrad Bloch hired him in Chicago, so he got a good job, okay? Very different. Now it's a four-year postdoc, maybe another three- or four-year postdoc, and then some people go into permanent orbit. And so places can be created as research staff scientists within laboratories, and they're called different things in different places. And that is kind of what you're talking about, and it's happening by default. But I don't think, at least in the United States, we've faced up to the issue in an organizationally reasonable way and dealt with it to try to make it optimal. There will be more of that. But on the other hand, we have to stop feeding the pipeline. You know, you hire an assistant professor, I'm sure it's true too here, assistant professor wants to have PhD students, of course. Someone's got to do the work, right? Okay? So, and then, by the way, they want to hang on to their PhD students, right? Because someone's got to do the work, right? But it has nothing to do with teaching, okay, necessarily how long somebody stays. What determines what the optimal number of PhD students? Has anybody approached it like a process engineering challenge? No, probably not. So, there's all of that. We in the United States, at least, we don't do that. We take as many students as we can afford without any responsible view of what happens down the road. And we shamelessly hang on to them until they're dragged away from us. Okay? It took 4 years to get a PhD when I was a student. I did mine in 2.5, by the way, okay? Which wasn't, by the way, an aberration at that time. And today, when I took over the department at Yale, the average, Ari Helenius will remember this, was about 6 years. I've now got it down to 5.5 from 6.5. My aim is to get it down to 4.5 before I eventually retire, okay? Because I don't think it's fair to the students. Anyway, good question. Sorry for the long answer.
Last question.
You mentioned the Max Planck Institutes, and you mentioned the contributions of the German scientists before the World War II. Many of those were in the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute,
correct,
the predecessor,
correct,
of the Max Planck.
Correct.
But I've read a little bit about it. I've not seen much dead wood, historically speaking, in the Max Planck, in the
Kaiser Wilhelm. I can't comment on that. You know, we celebrate people like Wieland, who was a director of a Kaiser Wilhelm Institute. And indeed, much of the research that I mentioned there in the earlier part of the century took place at those institutes. But we don't, you know, I wonder how much is the distance of time. You know, I mean we're all destined to be forgotten. It's only a question of the rate constant. So, you know what I'm saying? So what you say may be true.
It may be that the dead wood was forgotten earlier.
It could be, or it could be that Wieland used to beat his students, so I don't know. Maybe they were more motivated. It's a good question. I'd like to know the answer to that.
So I want to end on that comment with one more point that, of course, tomorrow there'll be a second lecture by Professor Rothman on the sorting of proteins to compartmentalize the cell, the story of three Nobel Prizes from a modern perspective. So with this, I think it was a wonderful evening, and we discussed and had a chance to actually discuss with question answer session at the end topics that are often overlooked in the hunt for the most recent discovery. Sometimes it's wonderful to look back and get ideas for what to do in the future. So Jim, thank you again.
Thank you.